on the Big Ten. A lot of you are probably SEC fans. I'm a Big Ten young man, and or maybe old man, whatever you want to call me, but grew up with the Big Ten. And I hope and pray that you can say you're teaching your children to grow up with the Big Ten too. The Big Ten Commandments. So if you would, take your Bibles and turn to Exodus chapter 20. Prominent newspaper recently ran an article. It contained a story about a dog by the name of Sweetie. Sweetie was a little black dog struck by a truck, presumed dead, buried by its owner. The shocked and heartbroken owner was even more surprised when Sweetie, who was hit by a small delivery truck, and when the owner got home, saw that the mouth of the dog was bleeding profusely, and the front paw of the dog was broken many times, and the dog was motionless, and the owner got down, and the owner's name, by the way, was Glenda Stevens of Park Hills, Missouri. She said she listened for the dog's heartbeat, didn't hear anything, so she went to the backyard and buried her dog, Sweetie. And she returned home just a few hours later with flowers, only to find that Sweetie had dug herself out of her grave and was with her mouth and jaws just barely coming out of the ground, was getting deep breaths and gasp of air. Assuming the pooch was dead, Mrs. Stevens thought she would bury the dog, but she didn't listen close enough for a heartbeat. Many, unfortunately, like Miss Stevens, they presume the Ten Commandments of God to be dead because it's Old Testament stuff. So they think the Old Testament and the Ten Commandments are dead. And they're taught that in schools today, all across our country, from Ivy League to Redneckville. It doesn't matter what school you go to, truth is relative, so everyone presumes there are no moral absolutes, which means there's no right and wrong. There's no white and black. Everyone assumes truth is whatever you want it to be. If it works for you, that's great. But truth is not relative. God's word is truth. Jesus Christ declared himself to be truth, and his word is forever. The Ten Commandments are for the children of Israel. But the principles that are taught in the Ten Commandments should and can be applied today. If you don't, you will be broken. In Deuteronomy chapter 28, it talks for just a few verses about what happens to people who keep and are blessed by the commands and the oracles and the statutes of God. And in a long series of verses in that same chapter, it is discussed what happens to the person who walks away from the umbrella of God's protection and God's commandments, and the burdens that is placed upon a person. If you go out to San Francisco and you cross the Golden Gate Bridge, you'll see on both sides of the bridge, there's this large fence that's been put up on both sides. The reason why that fence is there is because so many Californians and people in America were going to the Golden Gate Bridge to plunge themselves to death and commit suicide. They thought it was the easy jump off. And so the state erected a fence to keep people from jumping off the Golden Gate Bridge. Let me tell you something. When you jump off the Golden Gate Bridge, you don't break the laws of gravity, right? You can't break the law of gravity. You find out that you can be broken by the law of gravity. Lots of people think that the Ten Commandments are old, outdated, archaic, and that you can break the Ten Commandments. You can't break them, but you can be broken by them. God's word is forever. His commandments are forever. No matter what anyone tells you, every one of the Ten Commandments are still in force. The first commandment is mentioned in Exodus chapter 20, verse 3. Look with me there. You shall have no other gods before me. Right out in the margin of your Bible there, that's the who of worship. Verse 3 is the who of worship. Who should you worship? Well, we all know you should just worship God and God alone. But apparently the first commandment, which is the greatest commandment, is not enough. For nine others are there. The first four are all about our relationship with God. It's our upward relationship, how we handle and treat God. The first is who you worship. And the second is how you worship who you worship. And he went on to say in verses 4-6, you shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them nor serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generations, but of those who hate me, but showing mercy to thousands to those who love me and keep my commandments. The commandments of God are eternal guidelines. Psalm 119:89, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. And what God has declared in heaven, he has declared on earth. Though we are in the dominion of Satan right now, God still rules. He's still on his throne. So, as I said, the first commandment is the who of worship. The second is the how-to of worship. What is worship? A lot of people think they know what worship is. I think people, especially Christians, are very confused. If you think that we're calling a worship pastor, you're wrong. We're not. We're calling a minister to come and lead us in the music and the orchestration and the guidance of worshiping God through the worship, the corporate worship hour. But worship does not begin at those doors and end when we say the last amen. Amen. It doesn't at all. Worship, true worship, is whatever you do to the glory of God. So everything God said in the New Testament, everything you do, do all to what? The glory of God. So everything you do today, everything you do this week, should be an act of worship. Why is it that we think worship begins with music? I'll tell you why. Because Satan, Lucifer in heaven, was the worship leader, and he got us off track, mankind off track, from the very beginning. He got us looking at things, and like I said last week, first he gave us the distraction. Then he gives us the deception, and then he gives us the divisive nature of his instinct. He wants to divide us from God, divide us from one another. He wants you to be divided tonight, so he wants you to say, this pastor's all messed up in what he thinks about worship. What I'm going to teach you tonight about the second commandment and about God is straight out of God's word. I challenge you, in fact, I dare you to listen so intact and closely that you can find something that I say tonight that is not centered and skewed into God's word instead of upon man-made belief of what worship is and how we get it all mixed up. Worship simply means to ascribe worth or value to something. To ascribe worth or value to something. Everything you will ever become is of God. He is worthy of all the value you possibly can give him. Most of the songs that we just sang together were all about that. Crown him King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Do we really do that? Think about that. How we worship God through the work. How every act, everything we eat, everything we drink, everything we do should be in the name and for the glory of God. He is the master of the universe and should be the master of your life and of my life. Some years ago, the gifted violinist Fritz Kreisler learned that an old Englishman had a Stradivarius violin. It was a very rare and beautiful instrument. Kreisler went to the old man who possessed this violin, this rare violin, and he asked him for the amount that it would take for Kreisler, a noted violinist of the day. He asked him, how much would it cost me to purchase this beautiful instrument from you? And the owner of that violin said nothing. He refused, saying that the violin was not for sale. Kreisler was very angry, indignant. Do you know who I am? I'm the most notable violinist of the day. Let me purchase it. And he upped the price. And the gentleman said, there's not an amount. This violin is so precious, it's so rare, I wish to keep it as a family heirloom. For about 20 minutes, Kreisler stood there wondering what he was going to do. He made one more offer and the man refused, and he left very indignant and mad. He came back years later and said to the old man, he said, sir, I don't know who you're going to hand this violin down to, but before you do, I'm not going to insult you again by offering you more money, for I realize this violin is not only rare and precious, but it's precious and rare to you. But could I please just play one song on your violin? So the old man said, sure, go right ahead. So the master picked up that rare and beautiful instrument, playing the instrument as only a master could. The old Englishman sat there with tears in his eyes as Kreisler played. Finally, he stopped playing and offered an even higher sum for the violin, saying, I just must have this. And the owner said, I cannot sell that instrument to you, for only the master should possess it. And since you are the master, I give it back to you. You can have it, for only you should play that instrument. That is exactly, Christian, how we should handle the Lord with what he has done with his son, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came down and tried to pay a price for us, but because of our sin, we refused and rejected the price that he paid. We put him, our sins put him on the cross. God the Father was willing to pay the price for us, but couldn't, so he offered his only begotten son on the cross. Your life and my life, whether we eat or drink or whatever we do, should be in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. For only he and he alone can play your life out and make harmony of your life and mine. He alone is the only one who can make us unified in and through his body, the body of Christ. Martin Luther was quoted to have said, whatever your heart clings to and relies upon, that is your God. Anything you love more than God, anything you fear more than God, anything you serve more than God, anything you value more than God is your God. That's so very true. In American theology, which is the study of God, we have replaced the study of God with the study of self-service and self-meology that begins with me and ends with me. What is my preference? What do I like? What do I want? What is my preference? What is my genre? What is my version? What is my church? What? No, it is his. You live in his universe. You are a part of his plan. You are a part of his body. For you are not your own. You have been bought, redeemed with a price. So therefore, glorify God in your mind, in your body, in your spirit, which are not yours. They are God's. Everything you do should be an act of worship. Turn to the person next to you and say, everything you do is an act of worship. Paul wrote Timothy, young Timothy, in 2 Timothy 3, and he said, in the last days, men would be lovers of their own selves. And then he said this in Philippians 3:19, whose God is in their belly. Think about that. So true of the day we live in. Write these three things down. Some people have made God a God of wealth. of their money. You know people like that. They worship the almighty buck. Christ is their currency, God is gold, and their church is credit cards. And they're always yelling, charge. These types of people many times will never join a church because they think the church is a give-me organization. They look at the church as saying they want my dues. And some Christian treats their tithes like dues, as we learned years ago when we went through the book, I Am a Church Member. They think they're paying to the country club, and when they pay their dues, they have the right to grumble, complain, gripe, and have it their way. No, what you're investing in is the kingdom of God. As the Lord's Prayer says, on earth as it is in heaven. We're praying for God's kingdom to come down to earth. We establish that when God's kingdom reigns in our hearts. And when we have him on his throne. But some people worship the God of wealth. The Bible says covetous people will not inherit the kingdom of God. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 10. Some people also have made a god of their family. Everyone ought to love their family. You should adore your family. You should do everything you can to keep your family intact and to honor the institution of marriage, husband and wife, one for a lifetime. We should do our best to do that. However, some people have made family their God. You should never sacrifice God for your family. I'm encouraging you not to put your family first, but rather to put God first in your family. Make God a priority. Make him preeminent in your family. Everything you do in your family should be an example of your faith and trust in God. In Matthew 10:37, Jesus said, "He that loves his father or mother, son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me." Think about that. You wouldn't have an eternal mother or father, son or daughter, but by Jesus Christ. So put him first. Why do we do what we do with our family? Well, because it's the only thing in our lives that many times we have the example of real love. But outside of God, you would not know what love is. For God is love. Have you put your family before your faith in Christ? So you can put the God of wealth, you can put the God of family, or you can, thirdly, some Americans have made a God of pleasure. Think about that. Hedonism is the continual, insatiable appetite for pleasure. And pleasure doesn't have to always be sinful. Pleasure can simply be sports. It can be doing activity. It can be anything that brings you pleasure. And there's nothing wrong with that as long as it brings pleasure to God, who is your primary focus. But when our primary focus becomes pleasure, we become hedonistic. And there are many empires that have risen up and been totally insecure at the end of their existence because they became so secure in who they were with what they wanted and their desire to have continual insatiable desire that it ate them alive and they crumbled from within. In 2 Timothy 3, again, Paul said, men will be lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. If it's always your desire to have a high from a drug, from alcohol, from a feeling, from a buzz, from anything that is contrary to Christ or God, it is not putting God primary. Think about how we do that. Let's say a wife allowed her husband to sleep in on a Sunday morning because he wanted to every week, but she keeps waking him up every week. Honey, get up. It's time for us to go to church. And she goes up and gets the kids. And then they're in the middle age, they're empty nesters, and now no one's watching, the kids don't have to have that formative training, and he's using that excuse all the time with her. He's saying, let's just sleep in this week, let's just take it easy, and she does not do that. She will not allow that. She keeps waking him up week by week by week, being the great example of faithfulness to her husband. But one Sunday comes and she just looks over and says to him, let's not get up today. Let's just take it easy. And he's looking at her wild, like, sure, this is great. Snuggles in his pillow. He even puts his arm around and says, I just love you so much, honey. The second week comes and she says again, let's just take it easy. I mean, 2 weeks, it's not a sin, is it? So they lay in bed for a second week. The third week comes and she says, let's do it. It's a bad habit now. It was created not out of a desire on her part to be unfaithful. She simply was just tired that Sunday. And the second time she did it, she had had a tough week and things were tough. But by the third time, it became easier in the fences that they jumped. Now I want you to think about that. Men, if our wives allowed that, if our parents allowed that, think of how easy we would say to ourselves, man, this is just great. This is relaxing. I guess I really didn't need it. I'm not missing it that much. It would become a part of our everyday lives. And it has, obviously, in America, for many people. People are leaving, especially younger people, leaving the church in droves like never before. The church is still gaining, picking up people, but people are leaving as never before in our country. And what's crazy about it, we're just maintaining the numbers, but for the sake of argument, I want you to think about this, wives. So you come home after church, and your husband has that remote in his hand, and he's nice in his chair, and he's just flipping channels, looking at games and watching things, and you grab that remote out of his hand and say, honey, let's just have the afternoon off of television and not watch any TV and just sit here and talk. Communicate to one another. And to please your wife, you say to her, you know, I think that's a very good idea. Let's work on our marriage and talk about this today. And the whole time you're doing it, you're saying, boy, she better appreciate what I'm doing. And she does it a second week on a Sunday afternoon. You come home from church, you've gone out to eat, you're ready to nestle into your chair, and your wife comes in and she grabs away the remote. By the third week, you're going for your pistol, for your revolver, and you're going to take her head off. That simply would not happen. Parents, I want you to try this. Try it. Try to take from your children their cell phone. Try to take it from your mate. Try to take it from someone in your Sunday school class and see the wrath and fury of hell to be released from you. You see, because some things we naturally say, you know what? It would be nice to just sleep in and take it easy this week. Why is that? Because in the human psyche, it's easy to start a bad habit. And it's never easy within our sinful nature to keep remaining to be faithful. Remember that old hymn, it's not an easy road. No, it's not, but it's a better road. It's the higher road. So lots of people replace God with lots of things. I want you to think about how we idolize superstars and basketball players and football players and how we make them our heroes. Let me just, if I may, name a few. LeBron, Zion, Tua, Jennifer Lopez, Alex Rodriguez, Tom Hanks, Leonardo DiCaprio, Robert De Niro, Scarlett Johansson, Jennifer Lawrence. We've made heroes out of these people. And they have done nothing for you or me. They entertain us, but they have done nothing personally for you or me. Why do we idolize and make heroes and heroines out of people who have done nothing for us, nor will they ever do anything for us? Because we have this insatiable appetite to go after things that are beautiful and rich and wealthy, because we've put into priority the things of this world instead of the one who gave us the things of this world. Let me tell you who some heroes are in this church, without mentioning names. I stayed after church one night and talked to this gentleman who's a veteran in our church, who remembers going through the airport and having people spit on him and call him dirty, nasty names because he was a veteran and he honorably served in Vietnam. Now that's my hero. A man who still wears a hat for his country and has on the car, on the back of his car, a license plate that says, "I'm a United States veteran." He's prouder of the country who spat upon him. That's a hero to me. It's a hero to me, a mother and father who all their lives lived combating evil and being an example of faithfulness to the Lord and to his church. Always, in good season and bad, they always were faithful. I've met some awesome pastors in and through our convention and in and through our country. But no husband and wife ever matched the hero that my mother and father have been to me. All my life, they stayed the course. I hope I can stand on their shoulders and fulfill the promise that I made to God and to them by remaining faithful to him. Those are my heroes. What has happened that we've made the New England Patriots our heroes? And we've made the patriots who fought and died for our country, they're okay. They're good. They deserve our honor. They're not our heroes. What's happened to moms and dads being heroes in our lives? I'll tell you what happened. Satan has sold us a bill of good, deceived us, distracted us, and he's divided us, and he's dividing our families. And it's time that we take the high places back in our lives. My heroes, your heroes, should be the people of God's word, the heroes found in Hebrews chapter 11. If you would, take your Bible with me and turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 26. 2 Chronicles chapter 26. You've got to see this story of how quickly a nation crumbles with just weak leadership. 2 Chronicles chapter 26. Let me begin and just read a few verses in chapter 26. Now all the people of Judah took Uzziah. Now remember, Israel has had a tremendous civil war. The north, the 10 northern tribes, have become what we refer to as Israel. The two southern tribes became what's called as Judah. Israel didn't have many, if any, kings that were good after David, Solomon, Rehoboam. But Judah had, I think, out of 18, it had 8 good kings. But listen to what Uzziah did. Uzziah, who was 16 years old, and they made him king instead of his father Amaziah. He built Eleth and restored it to Judah after the king rested with his fathers. For the next 15 verses, it goes on to tell us about his troops, to tell us about his army, to tell us about his people. He not only made towers, watchtowers in the cities and all around the walls, which, see, enemies hated it when you built watchtowers because they knew that you could spot them from miles away if you were coming at them. So enemies tried to take down all the watchtowers. But watch this. Not only did Uzziah build watchtowers in the cities and on their walls, but he built them out in the middle of the desert. Why? Because he wanted to man those stations so that he would be ready if an enemy was coming to them. So he made towers, he made cisterns, he had herds and cattle. Why? Why did Uzziah have all that? Because God blessed him, and it tells us that in the Bible, right there in chapter 26. But then verse 16 happens. Something happened with Uzziah. He got pride-filled. He got cocky and arrogant in his latter years, in his midlife years. He got cocky, arrogant, and he started saying, "Look what I've built," when he didn't build it at all. God had built it for him. So this is what happened, verse 16. But when he was strong, his heart was lifted up to his destruction. For he transgressed against the Lord his God by entering the temple of the Lord to burn incense on the altar of incense. You say, well, he was a king and he just went in to burn incense. No. It's not telling you like a Catholic goes in and lights a candle or says a prayer. Not at all. He did what only a priest was commanded by God to do. He was king, not a priest. Now watch what happened. So Azariah, the priest, went in after him, and with him were 80 priests of the Lord, valiant men. And they withstood King Uzziah and said to him, "It's not for you, Uzziah, to burn incense to the Lord, but for the priests, the sons of Aaron, who are consecrated to burn incense. Get out of the sanctuary, for you have trespassed. You shall have no honor from the Lord God." But Uzziah didn't listen. Why? His head was lifted up. Proverbs 6, 16 through 19. From the head to the toe, God hates these six, yea, seven things. Number one thing, a haughty look, which means a proud look. It's the sin that commenced in heaven, and God threw Lucifer out of heaven for having pride in his heart. The same sin got Uzziah. Now, this is what you've got to see. He got leprosy on his forehead, and they spotted it, and they said, Uzziah, you've got leprosy. And for the rest of his kingship, he was not spared. He had leprosy, untouchable. So then his son Jotham took over. Look with me at chapter 27. Jotham was 25 years old when he became king. He reigned 16 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Jerusha, the daughter of Zadok, and he did what was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all his father Uzziah had done, although he did not enter the temple of the Lord, but still the people acted corruptly. Now it goes on to talk about Uzziah's son, Jotham. And this is what you must see. There was a temple split as a result of Uzziah going in and burning incense. With good intentions, Uzziah went into the temple to burn incense. But he did it the wrong way. Did you hear that? We're talking tonight about how to worship God. You can't worship God your way. This is what the Bible says. You can't worship your way, period. It's got to be God's way, not your way. It's not according to your preference. Uzziah went into the temple to worship God his way because he thought, man, God has blessed me so much. I have done so much for God. He would understand me doing the job of these priests. So he went in and he burned incense and he would not listen to the priest saying, no, that's for the sons of Aaron. He wouldn't stop. He kept going. With good intent in his heart, he did the wrong thing. You can worship God your way, but if it's not God's way, it's not the right way, period. So you've got to worship God God's way. Watch what happens to Jotham. He didn't go to church because, well, his daddy was hurt by the church, by the temple. So he did the right thing in God's eyes, and still he allowed the people to act corruptly. Now go with me to chapter 28, verses 1 and following. Ahaz, the son of Jotham, was 20 years old when he became king. And he reigned 16 years in Jerusalem, and he did not do what was right in the sight of the Lord, as his father David, which means King David, had done. For he walked in the ways of the kings of Israel. He made molded images for the Baals. He burned incense in the valley of the son of Hinnom, and he burned his children in the fire. Let me just stop right there. Baalim, which is Baal worship, Baal was the god of the sun, moon, and stars. He was the god of harvest. He was the god of the storm. Baal was the god also of fertility. In other words, every man did whatever he wished to do with the god of Baal. And you could make Baal your god and make him the god of anything you wanted him to because, well, that's what you do with a false god. You just set him up and you make him your god, whether it's money and wealth or pleasure and hedonism, or it's you and pride, or it's your family. It doesn't matter what it is. You can call that god by whatever name you want to call it. But in the end, it's a false god. It's a fake god, and it's fake worship. And here is the just 32 years removed from Uzziah, who loved the Lord with all of his heart. You have his grandson, Ahaz, burning his sons. Let me quickly just have a quick infomercial. It was one of the earliest forms of abortion. They'd set up Molech in the Valley of Hinnom. And Molech would be a golden or a bronze god, whatever they wanted it to be. And they'd hollow out his tummy. And they'd stoke up a fire within his tummy. And they would take their newborn children, typically the eldest, and they would offer that baby to the god of fertility, to god of harvest, to the god of whatever it wanted to be for them at that moment, because they thought that their gods would be appeased by offering up the most precious prize materials. Heathen people do. And this is what a king of Judah was doing. Oh, my friends, the day of grace And the age of grace is, yes, when we're living, but God has always been gracious to allow these things to happen. This was an early form of abortion where they would take a human small child, infant, right out of the womb and offer that child to the God of their age. That was just two generations removed from a king who loved God. What happened? Well, the first king jumped the fence and said, I'll worship God my way. The second king got mad at God and said, my daddy was punished because of what happened at temple. So I'll not go to worship, but I'll make it very good for all the people who want to worship. And he kind of was half-hearted. He loved the Lord, but he allowed the corruption of the people. The third generation came along, the grandkids of the first, and they burned up their great-grandchildren. How do you like that? How do you like what has happened in our country? It is amazing. Some of the things that are going on in today's age, we thought 20, 30 years ago when James Dobson said marriage will be nothing more than a contract, not a covenant, two men, two women and a man, three women and a man, four men and one woman, that'll be accepted in America. We thought, that's crazy. There are now lots of churches in Florida who are not dedicating children. They're dedicating their dogs, their horses, their animals to the Lord in a church. Because anything goes, because truth has become relative. And we've taken our eyes off of what God demands of worship. When we come to worship, what God expects of us when we come to worship. So I want to close tonight just by giving you a crazy simple outline that I think will help you to tie this in and make this practical, if I may. Give me three more minutes to make this very practical to you. Why should we worship God His way? Just put in the margins of your Bible or on a piece of paper, scribble this out. Don't miss it. These are three powerful points that you don't want to forget. Why do we worship? First, God desires. He desires our worship. The God of the universe, your creator, he desires your worship. You might think to yourself, I'm nobody. I'm nothing. No one loves me. People don't want to talk to me. They walk away when I walk near. No one may like you, but God desires your worship. God desires our worship. You say, are you sure about that? Absolutely, without a shadow of doubt, I can tell you right out of God's word, John 4:23, God desires those who worship him to worship him in what? Spirit and in truth. God desires your worship. Now watch this. In Revelation chapter 12, Ezekiel 28, Isaiah chapter 14, we learn about the myriads of angels that God created. And there are ranks and hierarchy within the angelic realm. There's at least, if I remember correctly, 12 ranks of angels. Lots of different types of angels. But all of them were created to worship God. Now watch this. They were created to worship God. Period. They don't have a choice. Revelation chapter 12 tells us that at this appointed time, back in Isaiah 14, pride was found in the heart of Lucifer, son of the morning. And God cast him out of heaven and down to earth. And at that time, it says in Revelation chapter 12 that the dragon swooped his tail and 1/3 of the angelic host, all of those angels in heaven, 1/3 of them fell with Lucifer. And forever and ever, it was cast, done, over. No longer are the angels given any choice. They were created to worship God. And some of them, 1/3 of them, we don't know the number of them, they chose not to worship God, and they made Satan their God. So they are damned and doomed forever and ever. That has forever been done by God, and God can do that because he created them. But you and I are different. You see, God created mankind. Genesis 1, 26 and 27 tells us God created you and me in his image. The angels aren't created in his image. They're created to worship him, period. Now watch this. You can't miss this. God created you and me in his image. We have free moral choice. The angels do not have a choice any longer. They're done. It's set in stone. 2/3 are with God, 1/3 are with Satan, period. They have no choice in that. But you have a choice not only tonight, not only tomorrow, but if you should live this next week, you'll have a choice every day this week. Every moment there you're awake, you have a choice to sin, not to sin, to serve self, to serve God. You have choices every day. God made you in his image. God desires your worship. Can you believe that? He desires you to worship him. That is an awesome thought. The angels had no choice. You and I do. So when we choose to worship God, remember the old imperial song? When we praise the name of God, when we praise him, everything falls apart under heaven and earth that's wrong when we choose to praise the name of the Lord. Remember those men who were in a dungeon, in a cell, praising God at midnight, though the earthquake had come. They were still praising the Lord, singing hymns and spiritual songs. Why? In the midst of their trial, they praised the Lord. And God inhabits the praise of his children, of his people. You were not created to worship him. You were created in his image. When you choose to worship him, you are choosing to be like his son, Jesus Christ, who humbled himself and worshiped God even on the cross, humbling himself to the point of death, so that you and I could be called children of God. God desires our worship. Secondly, God deserves. He deserves our worship. Revelation chapter 4. I'm certain I remember months ago when Jay read this before our choir sang a song. In Revelation chapter 4, a lot of angels are standing around in heaven and scrolls have been released. The throne room of heaven, and John has been taken up into the throne room, and he bows down to the Lord, and he's crying, and he's weeping, but the Lord holds him up and says, no, watch and see. And then he starts saying, immediately after this, I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne set in heaven, and one sat on the throne, and he who sat there was like jasper and sardis stone in appearance, and there was a rainbow around the throne, and it goes on to talk about his clothes of white, his hair. When he spoke, it was like thunder, and his eyes were piercing even into the hearts of men and women, boys and girls. And it says, before the throne, there was a sea of glass like crystal in the midst of the throne, and all around the throne, four living creatures full of eyes in front and in back. The first living creature, and it goes on to describe that. And all they do, the angels around the throne, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who is and was and is to come. He deserves our worship. The end of that chapter says, you are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created. God not only desires your worship, God deserves your worship. He is God, and he is God alone. Finally, God demands. He demands our worship. It is a commandment. Put up no false images. He is first. And how should you do that? You should not put anything before him. He should be preeminent in your life. He should be not just a priority. He should be primary. He should be first in your life. God is number one. He is the first thing that you do in the morning. You look up to him and you say, thank you, God, for this day. Give me a day that honors you. Use me as your vessel today to bring honor to you. And the last thing you do before you put your head down on that pillow is to say, thank you, God, for every trial, for every test, for every tribulation, for every blessing and every burden. I know that you have my best interest and I have your best interest, God. He demands our worship. When Satan came in Matthew chapter 4 and the Spirit led Jesus Christ out into the middle of the wilderness, he was tempted. Do you remember when Satan looked at the Lord and said, fall down, worship me, and I'll give you all this? Jesus looked back to him and quoted the word of God. He said, it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. Is he your God? Have you made him number one? Don't do what Uzziah did. For what will happen quickly in the lives of your children and grandchildren? The word of God is true. It's powerful. It's like a two-edged sword. It's able to pierce through bone and marrow and go right down into our heart. I pray and hope you've learned tonight in your heart of heart, put God first, not in what you do when you come to corporate worship, but in everything that you do, in everything that you do, whether you eat or you drink, whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. He alone is worthy. Lord, I thank you.